Okay. Good evening. I'm Mark Wilcox. I'm Assistant Chair for the Planning Board, and because of Janet McKay's absence out of town this evening, I will be acting as Chair for tonight's meeting. With that introduction, I'd like to begin the meeting by reviewing the correspondence which the Planning Board has received over the past month. First, we have received a memorandum from the Fire Chief regarding Elizabeth Heights. We have also received a letter regarding the Lawton public access waiver, a letter from the Code Enforcement Officer to Mr. Norman Lawton. We have also received a letter from the Department of Environmental Protection regarding the approval of our new zoning ordinance. We have received a letter from Jay Harris regarding the Beacon Lane public access waiver. We have received a letter from M. Edgar regarding the Cape Elizabeth Land Development Company's project. We have received also from Mr. T. Tinsman a letter regarding the same project of the Cape Elizabeth Land Development Company. We have received a letter from the town engineer regarding the Ridge Road public access waiver. And we have received a letter from P. Deshay regarding the Cape Elizabeth Land Development Company project also. We have also received a copy of the lawsuit filed by MC Associates against the town of Cape Elizabeth. And we have received the environmental and development newsletter of September, October 96, and the zoning news of June 97. To start the meeting, the first thing I would like to do is review the minutes of our previous meeting, now that we have that out of the way, and ask if any board members have any comments regarding those.
No.
Do I hear a motion?
I move that the meetings be accepted as written.
Second.
All those in favor of accepting the meetings of the minutes of the previous meetings, please raise your right hand. Except the notes are accepted unanimously. To begin the meeting, I have a special request that has been brought to the table by one of the applicants who will be on the agenda this evening. It is the applicant for new business, the Dominicus Crossing subdivision, and I would like to open for a brief discussion here the possibility that since this application has already been completely reviewed and approved, and that this is an application for an extension of their 90-day approval period for filing their approved subdivision plat, in light that is the only thing which we have to look at in this application. We've had a request from the applicant to move that to the top of the agenda, and I would like to open that for very brief board discussion to see if that is something which could be entertained.
I support that, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
I do as well.
I have no objection.
Okay. In that case, I would like to move the Dominicus Crossing subdivision to the head of the agenda. And at this point in time, if there is a representative from the applicant who can just give us a brief description of what is on the docket here, we'd be interested in hearing it.
Hi, I'm Amy Bell from Terrence DeWan Associates. Good to see you all. I'm not sure, Maureen, if it's easier for you to give a quick rundown as to the status, and then I can answer any questions.
What the applicant has done, they've submitted a complete set of revised plans, subdivision plats, and other materials, and we've been working on the approval that was granted by the Planning Board. I don't know if the board remembers, but you attached 17 conditions, and we're down to the last four. So the applicant is working on finalizing a performance guarantee. They won't be signing it, but it'll be ready to be signed. We're also working on getting a final letter from the Water District doing the final review on the conservation easement, and that's it. And for this reason, the applicant needs a 90-day extension so that they have time to take care of these last issues before the board signs a recording plat.
As to the status of those things, Richard Bryant's here tonight if you have questions about the letter of credit. The letter from the Portland Water District will be forthcoming. The Westbury, the project engineer will be meeting with them just to show them that all the corrections have been made that they had suggested. And a note that Maureen had us clarify has been revised on the sheet number 4 of the subdivision plats, and we have submitted that revised Mylar to Maureen, as well as having that note be revised in the covenants. Should I read that note or version? Okay. Just refer to the activities permissible outside the building envelope. So we should have everything in within a week or so. I don't see any problems, just needing another week.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I move that the 90-day extension request be granted.
Would anyone care to second that?
I'll second that.
Is there any discussion? Hearing no discussion, then, all in favor, please raise your right hand. Thank you.
Thank you.
Unanimously approved. Moving on to the old business now. The first item that we would like to review will be further presentation on the Beacon Lane public access waiver. A request by Elise Thibodeau and Kevin Zorski for an amendment to a previously granted public access waiver located at Beacon Lane, lot U15-66, which will include a public access waiver hearing under the terms of section 19-4-2B from the old zoning ordinance. At this point in time, it would probably be a good idea to start out with an update on the last month's activities and any further information from the applicant.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. the record, my name's John Upton, and I represent the applicants. If I could take a moment, I'd like to summarize what I understood the sentiments of the board to be as a result of our last meeting. First, I think there seemed to be consensus that the application that we brought before you was complete and that it was in order for you to consider our request to amend two of the conditions to the 1990 order dealing with the blocking of Beacon Lane and an adjustment to the site distances. With respect to the blocking, I believe that, or at least there was not much discussion regarding our position that the applicants had the legal right to prevent third parties from blocking their access. With respect to the question of site distance, there seemed to be a consensus that a site walk was not necessary, that the board members had a good feel for the locale. And some members did voice their opinion that a common sense approach to the question of site distances at this location was appropriate, where we had existing conditions, a road that used to be a public way had been abandoned. The condition existed now for over 100 years. There's no accident history at the site. There is a concern of neighbors to the property that we not change the character of Beacon Lane or the right-of-way area in front of two lights. And lastly, there was information presented through our traffic engineer, DeLuca Hoffman, that the traffic engineer's opinion was that you could accomplish safe entry and exit onto to Beacon Lane without strict compliance with the ordinance. And lastly, summarizing what I understood had occurred at the last meeting, the board requested the notice be sent out for a public hearing. we would like to reserve an opportunity to comment after the public's had a chance to present their views tonight.
Thank you. There was at the last meeting a substantive discussion of the technical data submitted to the Planning Board for review, and it was decided at that time that a further discussion, which would include a public access waiver hearing, would be desirable for this evening. So at this point in time, I would like to open a public access waiver hearing like that, and invite any interested party in the audience to come to the podium, briefly address the issues of public access, state your name, and let us know what you think of this application.
Good evening. My name is Ken Lane. Excuse me. I live at 5 Beacon Lane. I'm the owner of the West Beacon. I've owned that property and lived in Cape Elizabeth for 13 years. Many of us have concern about the dirt road that has recently been labeled by sign as Beacon Lane. One of the basic issues is, if you look at it during the winter after heavy rains, given the density of houses that have been built up over time, the road really is not a good access. I think for many vehicles, I mean, it's interesting this always comes up in the summertime. I'd invite you to look at that last October when we had all the rains. Beyond our concern about just basic common sense, we certainly have no desire to preclude the petitioners from enjoying their property. We would hope, though, that that road, before any further density, would be improved to at least some minimum level, which I would suggest that it does not now meet. Secondly, the portion of Beacon Lane that is paved and ends with the West Beacon is private property, and we intend to legally close that road, exercising our right to do so. It was closed 20 years ago with the help of, less than 20 years ago, with the help of Bernstein, sure, and the appropriate documents were filed, and we intend to do so again. Therefore, we would ask that as you consider the advisability of this whole issue before you, that you consider access to that property being the dirt trail to and from that property, and not necessarily rely on access through the private road, through the private property, known as Beacon Lane in the town records, and not the dirt trail beyond the West Beacon that recently has been labeled by sign as Beacon Lane. Are there any questions that I might ask about our feeling as property owners from any of the council? No. Thank you very much for your consideration.
Thank you. If there's anyone else who would like to come to the podium and express an opinion or present some information for the board in our considerations, we'd be interested.
Good evening. Thank you. My name is Peter Welch, and my wife and I and my family are abutters to Beacon Lane at 168 Two Lights Road. And I think I'm going to present my comments that actually I prepared for that last meeting, not knowing that it wasn't a public hearing at the time. My name is Peter Welch. I live at 168 Two Lights Road. I've lived there since 1979. I'm present tonight out of concern for your deliberations on the above question. I'm not personally familiar with the applicants, but have sympathy for their plight, and actually subsequently to the last meeting, I've met Elise Thibodeau. Our hope is that the board recognizes our effort to improve our property and the safety and aesthetics of the surrounding area for the public good. I brought with me some pictures of the area in question, but unfortunately it didn't pan out to be too good of a photograph, so. I ask that you please avail yourselves to visit the area, as I'm sure my pictures were not of professional quality. I ask that you be considerate of our property rights, physical and aesthetic. I seek that you be considerate of all interested parties in the community at large. To that end, I hope your conclusions are inclusive and not exclusive. Without delving into the details about obvious, to this novice, the site clearance and impediments east and west, I ask that you visit the site and use your judgment. We hope that fairness and common sense and appropriateness and a sense of community guide your decision. Please approach the area by vehicle and by foot and analyze it. If you find it suitable to the variance to the left of Beacon Lane because of the traffic pattern, I think you should find it suitable to the right. The community tasked this board the prerogative determination of including the prescription of a variance. A variance authority is prescriptive for matters that the community wants this board to determine on an individual basis. And I guess the gist of what I'm trying to say is part of the authority that you're empowered to deal with is issues that may be somewhat complex, don't fit the norm of all the scheduled apparatus that everybody tries to prescribe, and that's one of the reasons why you have variance authority. On a particular basis, again, I'm concerned about any potential impact on our property, physical and aesthetic. However, I'm also concerned that the board look at the applicant as well and understand that their issues are important, and to use your best judgments. And, you know, sometimes these decisions are thorny and they're difficult, but I hope you come to a spot that, again, is inclusive, that is recognizing the overall community needs and the responsibilities, obviously, you've taken on as board members, but also to exercise common sense and judgment and look at the issue that's in front of you by itself. I'd be glad to try to answer any questions if I can. Thanks.
Thank you. Would there be anyone else interested in addressing the board? We do not have a tremendously long agenda this evening, so I think we certainly, our time is at your disposal. Seeing and hearing no other persons interested in addressing the board, I will close the public hearing. At this point in time, I think it might be a good idea for the applicant to readdress the board in terms of sort of perhaps a summary of some of the information that was presented last time, particularly insofar as it has to do with the actual sort of physical treatment of the dirt road and what is intended for that.
Let me begin, and then I'll ask our traffic engineer to proceed. If I could just comment briefly on several points during the course of the public hearing. The portion of the gravel road known as Beacon Lane from Two Lights Road to where it becomes a paved road is the legal access of, I believe, five residents. And while it is not improved, it does serve as the only ingress and egress for those five residents. Elise Thibodeau and Kevin Zorski would like to be the sixth residents on that portion of Beacon Lane. With respect to your rights under the ordinance, I believe you do have a great deal of discretion. Perhaps a variance is not the appropriate legal term, but you do have the power to waive the site provisions on good cause shown, and I believe that counsel for the town has concurred in that opinion as well. I'm going to assume that there is no disagreement regarding the condition with respect to blockage. I've not heard that to be a concern of the board, so I'll pass on it unless you want further discussion and focus instead on the site issues, because I think those are the more critical provisions. And as I look back through the record, it appeared that in 1990, at the conclusion of the hearing when the board acted, there was a sense that the applicant should make an effort to achieve site distances in both directions, which is 350 feet in one direction and 250 feet in the other. And I think we pointed out at the last hearing that the 350 feet could only be accomplished if we removed ledge and raised the grade. You've heard the neighbors express the view that removing the ledge is not in meet with their favor, and indeed we would not like to do that unless the board directed that we had to. One alternative, I know that you have received a communication from the town planner suggesting that an approach may be to impose on us an obligation to request from the town council a speed reduction of 35 miles an hour down to 25 miles an hour, and we are certainly willing to make that request of the town council. In the other direction, we've got a situation where there are lilac bushes on private property. The private property owner has not consented to their removal. This I think goes to the heart of the common sense discretion. With a situation of this kind where the traffic in pattern in that direction does not appear to be significant, where there's no accident history, and our traffic engineer has commented about his opinion and the safety considerations, we think this is an area where a simple waiver ought to be granted to, in effect, adopt the existing conditions. With that, I think I will ask Tom Gorrell to comment on his observations since the last meeting.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, my name is Tom Gorrell, representing DeLuca Hoffman Associates, and we were retained by Elizabeth Thibodeau as well as Kevin Zorsky to complete an analysis of this situation. I don't really have a lot new to report to you since the last meeting. I guess I would, if you'd like, be happy to summarize some of the points we made in the last meeting just to refresh you for your discussions tonight, if you'd like. You'll recall, I think, in terms of there are a couple different sightline standards. Your ordinance references a safe entering sightlines, which are the ones that we normally would utilize at driveways. That, though, is a distance to enable the driver of the vehicle entering the roadway to achieve a certain level of speed and not inhibit the approaching traffic by more than usually 10 miles an hour or something like that. Stopping sight distance, on the other hand, is the distance that you have to travel to come to a complete and sudden stop. We do not meet these entering sight lines I referred to earlier. We do meet the stopping sight distance. In fact, exceed that. The restrictions that are in place are a ledge outcrop looking to the right as you exit the driveway. Mr. Welch, I think, was referring to that earlier. We would have to cut down that ledge outcrop in order to gain sight lines of about 350 feet in that direction. The posted speed limit for vehicles approaching from this direction is 35 miles an hour. If you're approaching essentially from the left as you're exiting the driveway, the speed limit's 25. We have approximately 250 feet available to the this direction and about 210, I believe, to the other direction. There is no accident history at this location. The other issue that we went through the other night was the right-of-way access. The existing road is actually a little outside of that right-of-way. If you were to put the roadway Beacon Lane within that right-of-way, you'd have to make like a 90-degree bend. That's not something that would be desirable for emergency vehicles at all. I don't think anyone really has had too much concern about the current alignment of the road. It's also desirable for Beacon Lane to intersect Two Lights Road at a 90-degree angle, which it does today. This is only a single-family residence, and as far as we know, it's probably about the last one that would be able to go in there. There are several options for trying to improve the sight lines. The westerly sight lines could be improved by raising Two Lights Road such that you would fill Two Lights Road in this direction to pick up the height, if you will, of the approaching vehicle. That clearly would be a considerable expense and not something that a single-family homeowner could support to correct essentially an existing condition. We could raise the grade of Beacon Lane itself. What that would accomplish is to lift the driver's height to eye, if you will, which would help out. The problem with that is that we'd run afoul of other conditions of the ordinance, which generally require you to approach an intersection at a grade of 3% or less, and that's since you're going to be stopping, particularly in wintertime conditions. So that's really not an option for us either. Another option is to remove the ledge. Our client is willing to do that, but that's not something that the abutters, the Welches, want done, and they certainly can respect that. A final option is actually to lower the speed limit. And along, you'll recall I said it was 25 miles an hour in this direction and 35 miles an hour in that direction. We could simply extend the 25 mile an hour speed zone by another 500 feet or so. What's involved there is that the town, not the applicant, would have to make a request to the Department of Transportation to reduce the speed limit from 35 to 25. They would do their own speed study and make a determination as to whether they felt that was appropriate or not. In terms of sight lines to the east, what we're looking at is essentially an interruption of the sight lines. We actually do have 250 feet of sight lines available, but the problem is it gets interrupted in an area that's kind of shaded in right there due to tree branches. So you can see them far enough away, and then they disappear for a few seconds, and then they reappear. Not an uncommon occurrence, but we'd like to have it cleared. Once again, to correct what is an existing deficiency in sight lines, it would require work outside the right-of-way. And that's not something that our client has been able to get permission to do. So they're willing actually to do improvements to correct this existing deficiency in both directions, but they can't obtain permission to do that, and certainly they do want to work with the neighbors in the town. You have had a review by Oast Associates, I believe, of our findings, and they had asked for a vertical profile, which they didn't have a copy of the last time, and we did furnish that to them. It showed the sight lines, and I think they concurred with that analysis. The westerly sight distance, they indicate that they support a application to reduce the speed limit from 25 to 35. They've also talked about an access easement from an abutter, which is, they felt, a good idea. The easterly sight distance, they've indicated that, yes, it does get interrupted, that we do have the 250 feet, and that the board needs to consider other things like the historical accidents, low level of traffic, and potential for additional development on Beacon Lane. As I indicated at the last meeting, our office always supports the ordinance or the standards that you have in place if you're in place in your ordinance. This, in fact, a lot of times we request more. This I do see as an unusual circumstance. It's really the first time that I've been associated with one that had all the elements that this does have to it. I think it is an unusual case. I would always be concerned about precedent setting, and I think that you need to be concerned about that when you deliberate on this. But I do think that this is a truly unique application, has a lot of unique circumstances to it. And for those reasons, I think in this one case, if indeed that existing deficiency cannot be corrected, then I would support waiving those sightline standards. Thank you.
Thank you. At this point, I think it would be appropriate if we begin board discussion of the application and the further information which we've received in our current packets. Would anyone care to offer some insights into this?
Mr. Chair, I have one question. There was reference to the issue of getting an access easement across the Welch and Rand parcel. Has that been investigated, and if so, what's the progress on that matter?
I believe the town planner has contacted the attorney for the Welches, and he has advised her that he was not in favor of authorizing or directing his clients to agree to it. We have not specifically asked them. If the board requests that of us, we certainly will make a good faith effort to marshal all the facts we can to for that purpose.
Is it your sense that there might be enough historical use of that property that the easement is implied to not only your client but to the other five or so households on Beacon Lane?
Well, I think it's certainly an issue, Mr. Emery, and I point out that the town attorney has certainly directly addressed it in his letter of today's date that I believe has been distributed, in which he makes note of the fact that the right-of-way has been in existence for over 20 years. I'm simply unaware at this point factually whether it has migrated for that whole time over into the Welsh property or not. And I don't want to suggest to you that I have facts that support that position one way or the other at this point. If requested, we certainly will make a good faith effort to try to obtain the consent of the Welches. So this is a problem that I think the town attorney makes good sense in the way he addresses it, that the applicants ought not to be precluded based on this issue, because certainly this is something that goes well beyond Elise Thibodeau and Kevin Zorsky. We've got a whole history of a road, formerly a public road, now presumably an abandoned road that's changed its location over time.
Thank you. I'm prepared to make a motion when the board has completed its discussion.
Go ahead.
Yeah, please do.
Motion for the board to consider finding of facts. Elise Thibodeau and Elise Thibodeau and Kevin Zorsky are requesting amendments to the previous public access waiver granted for Beacon Lane. U-15-66 under section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance. Item 2, Beacon Lane is an existing private gravel road that currently provides access for several lots, and little additional development is anticipated due to the lack of vacant lots. Three, the applicant has made a good faith effort to comply with conditions C and E of the approval. Item four, condition E is not needed because the applicant has demonstrated that prohibitions against blocking Beacon Lane already exist. Five, condition C requires site distance in accordance with the ordinance standard, which the planning board waives in favor of a stopping distance standard to the east. Six, reducing the speed limit from 35 miles an hour to 25 miles an hour, a distance of 500 feet from the intersection of Beacon Lane and Two Lights Road, would mean that available site distance to the west is in compliance with the town standards in the subdivision ordinance. Seven, the section of Beacon Lane that intersects with Two Lights Road is not located within the private right-of-way of Beacon Lane. Relocation of Beacon Lane off an abutter's property into the right-of-way may result in a turning radius that is insufficient for the town ladder truck. Eight, the amendments to the condition C and E substantially comply with the standards in section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance in effect prior to June 4, 1997. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Elise Thibodeau and Kevin Zorski for amendments to the previous public access waiver granted for Beacon Lane Lot U15-66 be approved with the following conditions. Condition one, that the applicant requests the Cape Elizabeth Town Council to petition the Maine Department of Transportation to reduce the speed limit on Two Lights Road in the area from intersection of Two Lights Road and Beacon Lane to a point extending 500 feet to the west from 35 miles an hour to 25 miles an hour. Two, that the applicant requests from the owners of lot U15-67 an emergency access easement for the town of Cape Elizabeth for that portion of Beacon Lane that intersects Two Lights Road and is not located within the right-of-way. Three, that the approval granted by the Planning Board on August 21, 1990, with the exception of conditions C and E, be incorporated as part of this approval. And four, that there be no alteration of the site nor issuance of a building permit until the plans and materials have been revised and submitted to the town planner, demonstrating that the conditions have been met.
Question for the town planner. In order to have any discussion on this motion, do we have to second it first? Okay. I'll second the motion. I'd like to make a comment. Mr. Ermey, would you be willing to take out condition number two, requesting that the applicant request emergency access easement? It seems like we're pushing these applicants into the same position they were in before by being able to have trying to request something that they're not going to be granted.
I think the key here is that we're only asking them that they request. We're not making a condition that they actually receive that
okay.
easement.
Mm-hmm. Fine.
I'd support Mr. Parkhurst's request. We're making we're putting a condition in here that it's just extraneous. They've tried all of this, and we're putting them right back in the same place. And I would also request that you consider that motion without number two.
I think the reason I would like to leave it in is that, given the unique circumstances surrounding this application and the various conditions that they've been asked to meet, and the fact that the Planning Board has been is waiving a site distance standard. Again, I want it to be clear, it's not a variance. We're granting a waiver of that standard, that in order to demonstrate to any other applicant coming after this that reasonable attempts were made to meet the requirements, and I certainly don't see anything terribly onerous about simply writing a letter to the abutter requesting a public access easement.
More in a point of clarification, then on conditions one and two are requests, not requirements.
Exactly. It was deliberately drafted so that the applicant has to show that they've made a good faith effort. If they succeed or fail, it doesn't matter. They've still met the condition.
Okay.
I would like to point out one thing. In my discussion with the town attorney, he had requested, if everyone has a copy of his letter, dated July 15th. He made a suggestion in the second paragraph about a finding the board may want to make.
Which one is that?
Is this the one that was on the...
On the podium this evening.
Okay.
Paragraph 2.
Mm-hmm.
I don't disagree with that. Mr. Emmy, would you amend the
would
motion?
Would you care to amend your original motion?
Certainly, I'd be happy to. Mr. Chair, I'd like to amend the motion to add item 9 under finding of facts. It states, under section 16-3-5, planning board, Cape Elizabeth Planning Board is given authority to waive standards. It finds undue hardship. If it finds undue hardship, practical difficulties may result from strict compliance with this ordinance. Upon showing that, as compared with strict compliance, such alternative 1 will not create more hazardous traffic conditions. And therefore, the board has authority to reduce the site distance in making a positive finding that in doing so, it will not create a more hazardous traffic condition.
Thank you, Mr. Emmy. Is there any further discussion on the seconded amended motion at this point? I have a question for Maureen, and again, revolving around the correspondence on our table this evening as we sat down. Attorney Harris for the Welches has indicated a refusal to grant an easement over that corner. However, in his letter, he used the term the public. An access easement for the public is not what is intended by this motion. I noticed that it was drafted and described as an emergency. What was it called? It was called an emergency access easement. Did you get any sense from Attorney Harris if the Welches are going to try to reserve that corner of the land and not allow fire trucks to enter Beacon Lane?
Mr. Harris was very accommodating. I spoke with him, and he was leaving for vacation in 2 days, and he made sure to take care of this before he left. The reason I drafted the motion, the draft condition, is because it does refer to a public easement, and I thought there might have been a little bit of confusion about exactly what kind of easement had been requested. It was also my hope that perhaps after the board takes final action on this and the Welchers are satisfied that there will not be alteration of the ledge, that they may want to reconsider and grant an easement. Mr. Harris did state that the road has migrated onto the Welch's property, and there was maybe some concern that it would continue to move over time. The point that I made was that an easement might, at least on paper, keep the road where it is instead of having it continue to migrate. The other concern I mentioned is that apparently the Welch's have, they have expressed no concern at all with keeping Beacon Lane where it is right now. And as long as they continue to feel that way, there will be no problem. But if at any point they have a change of outlook, or the property is sold and someone else feels differently, then it seems that the only way to resolve this might be through some kind of litigation. And the best way to do it is if everyone is basically in agreement to perhaps try to clear it up now. And that's why that condition was proposed for the board to consider.
I think it's a necessary that it at least be attempted. The language in the letter from Attorney Harris could be construed as being final, but on hearing that there still is the possibility for discussions, I would support the motion. Does anybody else have any further?
I just want to comment that we've heard from a traffic consultant, and we have an evidence, a record, that there have been no traffic accidents, no history of any traffic accidents at this intersection, and this is certainly a really important part of the consideration at least the motion that has been offered so far, and I don't think should be construed as a general planning board desire to waive site distance standards for all applications that might come before the board.
Any further comments? Hearing none, I'd request all in favor of the amended motion proposed by Mr. Emery and seconded by Mr. Parkhurst to raise your right hand. The motion is approved unanimously. Thank you very much. The next item on our agenda this evening will be the Elizabeth Heights Site Plan Amendment, a request by the First Atlantic Corporation for an amendment to a previously approved site plan of a 60-unit congregate facility located on Scott Dyer Road under Section 19-2-9, which will include a site plan review, public hearing, and Section 19-3-15, Housing for the Elderly, all under the 1990 zoning ordinance. At this point in time, I think an update from the applicant on current information on the project would be in order, and we can then resume our discussion of this. Thank you.
Mr. Chairperson, members of the board, my name is Craig Coffin. I am with First Atlantic Corporation. And First Atlantic Corporation is here tonight for a site plan amendment to the Elizabeth Heights Retirement Community. Elizabeth Heights is located on 32 acres of land on Scott Dyer Road. The reason we are here tonight for a site plan amendment is because the building has been reduced from 86,671 square feet to 45,141 square feet. In the approved plan, the structure was four floors. The new floor plan now has three floors. The building has been decreased in length, width, and height. However, there are still 60 units. The only changes are the type of mix. There are now 36 studios, 10 one-bedrooms, and 14 two-bedrooms. The approved plan could accommodate 102 residents. The new plan can house only 74 residents, a reduction of 28 residents. The approved plan had a covered parking area, which has been removed from the revised site plan because we have found that the majority of the population that tends to reside in this type of use tends not to drive or own motor vehicles. Furthermore, we feel the removal of the parking garage lessens the visual impact. Frank Cushing of Garwin Associates has completed the updated landscaping and lighting plan in the area where the prior covered parking garage was located. Also, we have extended the driveway in the rear of the building for the fire department access and added fire hydrants in the front and the rear of the building on the recommendation of the fire chief, Philip McGoldrick. Furthermore, the name of the project has been changed to Care Matrix at Cape Elizabeth on the recommendation made by Mike McGovern, town manager. With me tonight is the co-applicant, Care Matrix, represented by Kevin Fadden and Scott Cohen. Also tonight, we have Ken Hagen. He is the architect of record. And also we have Frank Cushing from Garwin Associates to update us on the landscaping and lighting plan. And Chris Vaniotis of Bernstein, Shore, Soria, and Nelson. I'd like to, at this time, turn it over to Ken Hagen, architect.
Good evening. My name is Ken Hagen. I'm with John Sheskin Associates. We're architects in Quincy, Massachusetts. And except for the name change, I'm here tonight with the same boards that were presented last time on June 17th. For the benefit of anyone who was not here then, I'd just like to give a brief description of the project. As was mentioned, the site plan, there are basically two changes that are being proposed. One is a reduction in the size of the building, which can be seen here by the lighter green outline. That's the approved plan. The smaller footprint is our proposal. It is a reduction of about 9,000 square feet, which will become green space. In addition to that, it's been pulled in around the perimeter and pulled in substantially on this end of the building. It's about 60 feet, which opens up views as we approach the building on this drive out to the marsh. It also opens up views from these houses in that direction. The second major change, as mentioned, is the elimination of the parking shed, which had 22 of the 74 parking spaces inside. Frank Cushing will address in detail the questions that arose last time about the lighting and the landscaping in that area. But in general, the intent is that everything else about the site plan stays as approved. Any conditions that were part of the previous approval are also valid now. These are the floor plans, and as discussed, there are 60 units on three levels rather than the previously approved four levels. The previous mix was 18 one-bedrooms and 42 two-bedrooms. Now, the current mix is 36 studios, 10 one-bedrooms, and 14 two-bedrooms. So most of the square footage has come out of the units. They've been shrunken in size. A lot of the features on the original proposal are still current. The drop-off with the covered walkway, the half-level entry. We've included a fireplace in that front entry with a stone chimney. And the materials, as discussed before, on the exterior of the building are all wood siding, clapboards on the lower levels, and wood shingles on the upper, asphalt shingles on the roof. These are the front elevations. The main entrance is here. These two fit together as the building bends around the site. These are the two end elevations. And these are the rear elevations. The rear is treated pretty much the same as the front in terms of detailing and materials. And with that, I'd like to turn it over to Frank, who will address those specific questions that were raised last time.
My name is Frank Cush. I'm a landscape architect. Much of the, actually, the original site plans that you have on this are the approved site plans. I authored much of it and coordinated the consultant team at that time 6 years ago. One issue I believe that occurred the last meeting was when the parking becomes uncovered, what happens visually to the parking lot and also buffering of those parking areas. I've prepared recently a landscape plan which is primarily ornamental but also functions as a buffer for that parking area. Just want to run through it quickly for you. What was left after we removed the parking structure is a fairly generous island, which is a full 16 feet wide with two larger returns on the end. What we're proposing is to raise the grade in there gradually and berm it up 2 feet, so that automatically gives any planting an extra 2 feet in height. The planting within that would consist of a canopy of hawthorns, Washington hawthorns, which is a fine tree. It has three-season interest, a very dense foliage and branching, white flowers in the spring, a fine fall color, a nice red berry, and that would be the primary plant in the island. It would also have an understory planting. In and around the trees, there would be a spreading yews to, again, give some screening under the trees and also be shade tolerant. Now, between the hawthorns, we've changed to pairs of gray owl junipers, which would give you a contrasting color, but also, again, that understory evergreen screening. And on the car side, we've added a row of Japanese spiraeas for some spring color. That, in my opinion, from in screening that parking lot from as a northerly or a westerly view would be quite effective. The screening of that parking lot looking south and east was approved previously with an evergreen tree planting of white pines. There were 14 of them, 8 feet tall, and they were staggered across the northwesterly side of the parking lot in this area. And fronting on that, there was also three pink spire crabs, which would remain. I have brought our lighting plan with us. We've retrieved that from the archives. The lighting of the parking garage or covered parking area consisted of 200 watt high pressure sodium McGraw Edison fixtures, a traditional design. They were at a 16 foot mounting height, and they were arm mounted off of the structure here. Here, there was also some pendant lighting inside of the structure, illuminating the ground plane. with the absence of the structure, the pendant lighting disappears, but we still maintain our 200 watt HPS fixtures on a 16 foot mounting height, and that would be on a direct burial fiberglass pole. So you still have essentially the same illumination of the area occurring there. With the absence of the pennant, so there would be a little less intensity, a few less lumens, but still an illumination of that same parking area with the same lights. I've communicated with Mr. McGoldrick, the chief, with regard to extending that gravel. It's actually a gravel sub-base over 2 inches of loam so that we can have green off the back of this building but still allow a hard surface for the emergency vehicles to get around the back. He's requested that it be extended in another 60 feet or so. I believe the applicant has already agreed to that during a previous building permit phase. And that's shown here in the green. The chief has also requested a hydrant in the rear of the structure. That's shown in this red dot. This information has been faxed to the chief, and we've discussed it on the telephone, and it, I believe it's to his satisfaction at this time. And I'm certainly, if there's any questions, I'm here to answer those, I guess. Here we are.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Again, this application is similar to the last one in that there was a significant review of all of the technical details as well as the overall project at our previous meeting. It was decided by the board at that time that public comment under the site plan review portion of the ordinance at that time allowed for a public hearing, and it was found to be something that would be desired by the board. Therefore, at this time, I'd like to open a public hearing. Public hearing now being open. If anyone in the room has some information or an opinion to express and would like to address the board, please step to the podium. Give us your name and address, and we'd be very interested in hearing any comments.
My name is Ellen Patterson. I live in Cape Elizabeth Park on Longfellow Drive. I'm quite interested in how this is going to impact our sewer and water. We've had a new sewer, and after so many other things were added to it, there isn't enough power and strength as we used to have. I've heard nothing about what is going to happen with all of this added to, is that going to be added to the same sewer?
Okay.
How is it going to impact on us people on Cape Elizabeth, especially on Longfellow Drive, which I believe that is going to come next to Longfellow Drive as nearly as I can tell from the plans. Okay. I'd be glad to hear about this.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Would anybody else like to address the board with comments or opinions? Please feel free.
Jim Messerschmidt, 39 Longfellow Drive. I believe all of you should have a copy of a letter I sent to you. And all I would ask is that someone read it into the record, and if you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer them.
Letter. Does anybody else in the room this evening care to share a comment? Thank you.
Jane Vachon, 28 Longfellow Drive. I want to thank Mr. Carlson. I believe he made the motion for those of us who were not living in the neighborhood at the time that this project was approved, that a public hearing be suggested, and I thank him for that. And since it has been approved prior to my moving to the neighborhood, there's not much I could say except that I find it, there is beautiful trees there. I didn't do some of my homework, so there are some things that I don't know. Number one, that has never been, those 32 acres of land have never been the property of the town of Cape Elizabeth. Is that correct?
I don't know, but we can request
it must have belonged to someone else. So we don't have that much to say about that property, but it's interesting that we're going to plant trees when there are so many trees there already, so I'm feeling bad for the trees that I'm going to miss. I use that as a walk. I bring my dog for a walk, and I'm going to miss that unless there is some access to those of us who have been using that land, perhaps not legitimately, but it has been a source of relaxation and recreation. I guess the other thing I wanted to say is that will the three stories be something that we're going to see from Longfellow Drive? I don't live exactly here. I'm across the street. But is this something that we're going to have to be faced with in terms of viewing? So that would be another question I would like to ask. And thank you very much.
Thank you. Here we go.
Reagan Bartlett, 33 Longfellow. I, too, was not in the neighborhood when this particular plan was approved. My specific question, having looked at what the plans are, is how much attention has been paid to the current state of the trees that are there. One of the things that I see, because this is my property here, is that there's an enormous cherry that is, I can't tell in terms of their surveying whether or not the cherry's on my land or whether it's on their land, and it is a huge tree. It was beautiful in its day, but we're talking 7 years ago, and it is in a state of disrepair. I'd be curious to know if there has been any kind of land survey by the landscaping people to see what the current status is of the property so that they can continue with the landscaping that stands there now.
Thank you. Are there any others interested in coming to the podium for public comment? Since there's no one else indicating an interest, I'll take this opportunity to read Mr. Messerschmidt's comments from his correspondence so that it can be entered as part of the public hearing itself. He drafted a memo dated July 14th, 1997, regarding the First Atlantic Corporation's congregate facility. And in it, he requests that the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board address the following concerns before approving First Atlantic site plan. One, once the facility is built, what evidence exists indicating the viability of attracting a reliable and financially sound buyer? Has adequate market feasibility study been completed, specifying the resident target population and the viability of attracting such population? Given the fact that First Atlantic recently scaled down the size of the facility for, quote, marketing reasons, unquote, the answer to both questions seems important to avoid the construction of a, quote, white elephant, unquote. Concern number two is, has an adequate environmental impact study been completed? Given the fact that approximately 20 bird species frequent the area, what impact will such a facility have on wildlife? And number three, what will be the role of abutters in determining the quality of the buffer? And that is the end of the memo. If anyone has changed their mind at this point and would care to come to the podium, we have a little more time and would entertain any further public comment if anyone cares to do so. Seeing and hearing none, I'll close the public hearing. Thank you. And at this point in time, I think it might be a be good to begin to review in further detail concerns of the board. If the applicant wishes to update us on further detailed efforts of theirs and overall plans for the facility, which might help us at this point, we'd appreciate that.
Great. Thank you for that opportunity.
Thank you.
The first issue was the sewer capacity. We have prepaid for those, for that capacity back in 1990, and that's being reserved for this project, and we've also had dialogue with the with the Public Works, and there is capacity for this project. The public access is something that was a lot of time was spent on, and we've also, through that process, with the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, have given them easement over the property. Do you have the actual access showing the different properties?
Yeah, they're described. Described here verbally, and they are there's an access from Scott Dyer Road right up the middle of the site. It connects with our parking lot. You would walk around the grass area or the parking roads, and you'd gain access around to the west of the building, and then a trail would head up across dry land and connect with the sewer easement. There's also an opportunity to walk on the sidewalk to the east, and also drop down
to the lower path.
Yeah, to the lower path.
So the paths that are existing are still open to the public for use, and that has been developed over time, and that's been, you know, we've given that easement to the public. View from Scott Dyer Road, I guess, was an issue, and Longfellow Road, and that has been addressed in the past. The only area that's being disrupted is just in the area of where the road is and the parking area and just around the immediate building. Everything else on the site stays as is, and certainly along the perimeter here stays as is, and we've actually added a considerable amount of vegetation in this area. Frank Cushing had a team at one time, and they actually went to each home and visually increased the vegetation based on the views of the new structure. Mm-hmm. So a lot of time was spent in that to accommodate the abutters. And the financial capacity of Care Matrix, I believe you have that information. The financial capacity of Care Matrix, that information's been submitted. We do have additional copies if needed tonight, but they are a publicly traded company and certainly have the financial capability to create this project and follow through and manage and operate it. Thank you.
Thank you. At this point in time, I think the board can resume their discussion of the project. I'd be interested in any comments or any requests for further information that any of my fellow board members may have.
Mr. Chair, I just failed to jump in before the applicant got up, but at the last meeting I recused myself, believing I had a conflict of interest, without realizing that the First Atlantic Corporation and the corporation with which we were are engaged at the Nonsuch Golf Course, I thought they were the same corporation. They are two distinct corporations having nothing to do with one another, which is my understanding, and certainly I have nothing to do with First Atlantic Corporation, so I've elected to unrecuse myself or re-include myself, whatever you'd like to say, and continue with discussions.
Thank you. I guess maybe I'll start out with one question, just hitting on the last item that was presented to sort of get the ball rolling. The the role of Care Matrix in the project has been referred to, and I'm trying to remember how it was presented originally, but is Care Matrix at this point in time a de facto owner of the project contingent upon our approval, or is are there further negotiations or things left to be taken care of there?
That sounds like an appropriate question for legal counsel. Chris Maniotis representing First Atlantic Corporation. Care Matrix has a contract, the binding contract, to buy the property. That is contingent upon approval of the amended site plan and the reduced project size. But once the approval occurs, the closing will occur shortly after that. So they've joined as a co-applicant so that you have both the property owner, which is actually Cape Elizabeth Realty Trust with First Atlantic as their agent before you, and you have the prospective owner, Care Matrix. But yes, it's under contract to Care Matrix.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
At this point in time, would somebody from Care Matrix or, again, legal counsel care to update us on prospects for construction and construction schedule and when this will all be happening?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Kevin Fadden. I'm a development officer for Care Matrix, and we're located in Needham, Massachusetts. And as the attorney mentioned, as soon as the approvals are in place and all of our architectural is done, which is ongoing right now, we would like to start this, as I mentioned at a meeting earlier this summer, we'd like to start this job this fall if the board sees fit. In answer to this gentleman's memo, we have in-house marketing and have done an extensive market study of this area. We've had people who have spent time visiting all the competition, photographing it, interviewing residents, and we're very comfortable that the marketplace will support the facility as proposed. It would not have supported the facility as originally designed at 86,000 feet, but it will support the facility, which will provide a quality of care for the residents. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Do any of my fellow board members have any other questions or discussion to offer? Yes, Tom.
Mr. Chair, I was on the board when this originally came before the town of Cape Elizabeth, and recall the extensive site walk that we had and the great care that Frank put into putting together and meeting with the abutters in terms of looking at sections and dealing with the issues of buffering and the impact of the building on views from the adjacent homes. Unfortunately, we don't have that information in front of us, but according to our packet, that all of that will still be part of this approval and expected to be implemented as part of this project. I have a couple of questions. One is in terms of the nomenclature of congregate care. Is this assisted living? Is assisted living something quite different than congregate care?
They're all pointing at me. Under state law, under Maine state law, this is a congregate care facility. And the and state law really looks at the nature of the facility itself. So under state law, a congregate housing facility is one in which each of the units has cooking facilities and bathroom facilities. And in addition, there is a common dining area and services are provided to assist the residents living there. So it's a congregate care facility, not an assisted living facility under the state statute. And Craig, who's in the business, is nodding that I've got that right. The statute was just amended, actually, effective January 1st of 1997 to fine-tune some of those distinctions.
Who would be the competition that you would have visited? Just to give me an idea of the type of facility that this would. If I were to travel around and look at other projects around Greater Portland, our firm's involved with a couple. I don't know if they compete with us or not, but they're in final review phase as well. So I know there's a lot of these things up and being developed. So I'm just curious as to what the type of project is. And assisted living is a phrase I've heard a lot. Long-term care, I know, is something quite different and not what this is to be.
Craig will answer that. I'm sure he'll tell you about this facility in Falmouth.
Thank you.
A similar project this would fall under would be like a Park Danforth, an Ocean View, the Highlands up in the Brunswick area. The project is still considered congregate. We still have the same services. We have the same common areas. We have the same mix of units. Not the same mix of units, but the same number of units. We have the, you know, the apartments with the kitchens and the services to service those apartments. These residents here really don't fall into, per se, an assisted care environment, similar to, say, a Crescent House next door, for example. These residents here would not get the services that you would get in assisted care. They wouldn't be getting daily health care, for example. They're there. They're more independent. They tend to want three meals a day. They want the activities. They want to be able to get transportation, to, you know, the shopping, the different, you know, the main mall, the movies, the shows. If they did need services up beyond what would be offered, they would be through home health.
Thank you. And I think just to be clear, Mr. Coffin, I think you mentioned that the town manager had, you stated that the name had been changed to Care Matrix Cape Elizabeth or something to that effect at the request of the town manager. That's to say that the town manager requested that the name be changed, but he didn't specifically request the name that you've selected, I trust. Okay, thank you. The previous approval, at least in this, in the very schematic plan that, that you included with your set from Gowron Architects, indicated that there's some sort of a garden terrace in the back of the facility. What, without seeing final plans, I don't think there's any way of assessing sort of the amenity package that goes along with this project. Do we assume and state that for the record, that, that this project would have the same amenity package that the previous project had as it was approved?
Amenities being inside the structure?
No, outside.
Outside.
The, if I vote in favor of this, I'm going to assume that I'm voting for an amendment to a previously approved application, and while the building has changed very little, I would assume that when I go out there, if I take Gowron's site plan, I'll find all of the amenities attached to this building. They may be configured slightly different, but if there's a garden terrace shown on the Gowron's previous approval,
yes.
Unless you specifically request an amendment to that, I'll assume that that's part of that, what we're voting on.
That's correct. And I believe those terraces are due to the topo around the back of the building and around the sides of the building.
What they are?
Yeah.
Well, what they're
envisioned to be is a hard surface pavement of an attractive pavement, probably pavers, and it would be a seating area for people, and it's adjacent to the dining room, and it would be landscaped around it in a style congruous with the interior design and the style of the architecture. Some of that is not delineated yet. That occurs in a design development phase, but I mean, choosing the colors of the daylilies and that sort of thing, you can't really do at this time. Well, you can, but I mean, it could be a mistake. I'd like to put that off till design development.
Is the sign, for example, going to be similar to what's shown here? We have a sign that, that suggests we have Cape Elizabeth, Elizabeth Heights retirement community that's done in a shingle style with a stone base, which is very sympathetic to the original architectural finish. Maybe I should address this to the town planner. Does the planning board assume that, that all of these, if it's not specifically requested to be changed, that the package is short of asking for a completely revised set of drawings that would indicate specifically what the limits of any sort of site improvements.
Mr. Chairman, can I maybe help with that? And I know the question was supposed to the town planner.
Please do, Mr.
Certainly tell you what From the applicant's perspective, Mr. Emery, the answer is yes. The only things that we're proposing to change are those things that we've shown you that have changed, and our intent is everything else stays the same, except the name on the sign, obviously, that will have to change, for example. So we're perfectly willing to live with, and if we haven't put it on the plan yet, we'll certainly put on the plan a note that indicates that all the previously submitted plans and all the previous conditions of approval remain in effect and are incorporated into this approval. So we really are asking only to change those things that we've indicated are changing and to do everything else exactly the same as the existing approval.
Okay, thank you. It was noted at the last meeting that since the building is smaller, the building has less impact. I heard some other comments with respect to the massing of the building. It's, I guess I'll use my professional opinion, that the previous building had more articulation, for lack of any other term, of the masses, and actually sort of grew out of the ground, and although it was a larger building in terms of square feet, it may have been less imposing on the site. However, I understand in with concern of budgets, you have gone ahead, though, and you've simplified the building form, but you've also indicated on the plans that the exterior finish will be shingle, cedar shingles or wood shingles and wood siding. I won't enter any further discussion about the architectural design as long as I understand that that's indeed going to be part of this project and it won't be value engineered to vinyl siding and vinyl shingles or some other simplified surface without the planning board being duly notified. I guess the last question I have in terms of wetland impacts, it's my understanding that wetland regulations have changed several times since this project was reviewed, and although you have local approvals that have been continued throughout the years since 1990 or thereabouts, several wetland regulations have changed at the state and federal level, and I don't see anything in your package that specifically addresses that. I'm not requesting that you go out and remap the wetlands based on the new federal regulations, but I would just simply ask that you provide a letter or some notification to the town planner that gets included with a packet that based on the site plans as submitted or as you amend for this particular building that there's no state or federal wetland impacts. You know, you might be into a tier one or something like that, but just to be sure that that's covered. So
if I could, Mr. Chairman, just I'm not a wetlands analyst, but we know that there's no filling of wetlands involved at all. All the construction is staying out of the wetlands. We do anticipate that there may be a permit by rule requirement or a permit by rule to obtain from the DEP because the road will come close enough to a protected wetland that we'll probably need a permit by rule for the road, but we've done that part of the analysis. But in terms of requiring an Army Corps permit or a DEP permit for any filling, there is none. So it's proximity to the wetlands at a couple of points along the road that may require us to get a permit by rule.
Okay. Last I had mentioned, I believe it was at your initial workshop, the issue of the elm tree out at Scott Dyer Road. That was an issue at our original sidewalk, and the sidewalk is shown on the Gowron plan as going around that elm tree. I would expect that all due care will be taken and that elm tree, although it's not depicted on your schematic plan, will be protected and be part of this project.
Most definitely.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's an asset.
Yeah.
Project.
That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Do any other board members have any
Mr. Wolf,
questions or comments? Yes, Peter.
To the applicant, either the architect or the landscape architect, on behalf of the two people who spoke tonight during the public hearing who are new residents of the neighborhood and were not here when this project was previously approved, when you did do extensive work with the abutters as far as landscaping and what the visual impact would be, if in your own words, if you could describe to them, if you stood in the backyard of one of the abutting homes or in the front yard of one of the homes on the opposite side of Longfellow Drive, could you describe to them what you would see if you looked towards your project? And I won't hold you to it verbally, just give me an idea of what you intend to make as a visual impact.
Well, you would have to pick a point of view from. It changes
from every step you take down Longfellow Road, your view changes.
For the sake of discussion, if you could put a home right in the middle if you want.
The first thing, most obvious, are the homes are very closely built together. The side yards are maybe 20 feet apart and so on. So you have these alleys between the homes, and most of them are landscaped to begin with, with hedges on the property lines and such. So there's a lot of detail, human-scale architecture and plantings going on along Longfellow Drive. When you do look beyond the house or from the backs of the homes, which is the homes on the west side of Longfellow Drive, the homes that are most likely to have the views out into the property, you have a mature line or line trees that grow along there. This was mentioned, some mature cherries. I know there's some pines, willows, I can recall those. Beyond that, you have a wild succession growth of meadow going on. I have, where's... This is a seven-year-old photograph, but it gives you the character of the vegetation out there. It's low and it's succession growth. Quite often it's very dense in pockets. This is what you're looking out at. This is a view from Scott Dyer Road, the highest point on Scott Dyer Road. And that was a view up the most open area that you could find to photograph up to. But that's the character of the vegetation that's out beyond the tree line. What I wanted to explain, I guess, is the buffer. The least expensive tree you're going to buy is one that you save on the property. So we've gone. We're 50. It's 50 scale. 75 feet from that stone wall line, or the old stone wall fence line, or where people are maintaining as a property line, 75 feet into the property remains undisturbed. So all of this type of vegetation remains there. What we did, or what I did over a couple weekends, was meet with the property owners, and we looked in the backs of the properties out over the project site. Determine what was there and where any weak spots were in the buffering, and devised a plan to fill in the holes. So you'll notice on the landscape plan there's some lengths of wood fencing where that was desirable to do. You'll see runs of native trees, indigenous trees, malus, which would be vermeer dug and planted in holes. You'll see evergreen trees. You'll see some understory planting in there. Most of it indigenous or wildlife type plantings. A lot of care and thought went into devising this buffering scheme, but it's one of preservation and one of planting. That's the Thank thought you. That's gone into that. Yeah.
One further question: would they be able to see the building?
With the trees off, and at night, maybe. I'm sure they'd see some lights in the windows and such. From a second story window, yeah. I mean, I don't think we can screen that, but there'd be some limited views, visual access to that structure.
But from what you described, it's not necessarily going to disrupt their backyard.
No. Well, it's not their backyard, no. This is a beautiful piece of property, and it's been open for years, and people, it's a heart-wrenching thing sometimes to see this, when people have enjoyed it for so many years, to see development occur here. We've attempted here in this buffering to minimize and mitigate those kinds of impacts for the people. We preserved 75 feet undisturbed and even further into the site, so that those foreground views can still enjoy those. We've also provided access across the property so that they can still move across the property. We've consolidated the use of the site and the land use and kept it as compact as possible to preserve that open space. I think there's other planting going on here. There's another layer of planting, which is much further into the site in the disturbed areas, and those would be evergreen trees. You know, we can look ahead to the years, you know, 15, 20 years ahead, where whatever limited views you had of that building would be screened out by those evergreen trees. There's spruce and pine. There's a couple different species of pine and so on, but that's inside the prop, inside, you know, 100 feet in or so.
Thank you.
Mr. Emery.
I'm only raising my hand to follow up on Mr. Carter's question in another way. Is there anything about this building that is either higher, is it volumetrically have more impact in any way than the one that was previously approved, and the one with which the screening had been so carefully planned and developed?
The overall height is slightly lower. It's about a foot lower than the previous proposal. At this point, which on the site plan is this elevation, it's about 42 feet from finished grade to the top of the ridge. There is a series of elements above that, these cupolas, for instance, but that would be to the top of that ridge line. So there's, other than reducing the bulk of them, pulling it on the ends, there's not much of a change in terms of height.
It's actually farther away from the adjacent properties than the previous plan.
Right. This is the edge of the previous plan. This is pulled back here. It's pulled back slightly in the front here as well, and this element has been removed.
Thank you.
I'll offer a comment to continue that discussion, just so that as a board we are aware, and it is a part of this proceeding this evening. I think if one were to look at the relative areas of vertical wall versus roof, to the earlier scheme, one would find that in the earlier scheme there were more units which, if you will, were sort of part of a sloping roof and integrated into dormers, and less vertical wall. So there is a difference, even though the overall building is slightly lower, if you will, a predominant eave line is higher in this scheme, and that is change in the project for which this amendment is being sought. I have a further question regarding the access and access easements which are on the site. From the way they were described a few minutes ago, it sort of sounded like they perhaps go around the building also, in addition to merely being sort of a straight connector from Scott Dyer Road down to the sewer easement. The earlier easement for the project back 6 years ago described a sort of a simple three-component access easement scheme, whereby there was one element which was the above the sewer itself running east-west adjacent to the marsh, another element which overlaid what was called the ancient roadbed, which was merely a straight thing to get you from Scott Dyer Road down to that sewer easement, and didn't sound like it went anywhere else. And then one other access easement, which would be from the Longfellow Drive into one of the first two. So I was wondering, and I think on the plans, it looks like they're a little bit more elaborate than that. Is that something which you are proposing at this point in time?
Maybe we'll let Frank Cushing get up and address that, but they haven't been changed.
Okay.
I mean, when the revised site plan was presented those haven't been touched at all. So maybe Frank got confused or got you confused as he was describing them, but those are in exactly the same locations. The architect's pen has not touched those whatsoever. So they're in the same places as they were before. The language for those, the actual easement documents, have yet to be drawn up. They will at the time of building permit. You've got some, Maureen? Oh, okay. Maybe they were delivered at the time the building permit was issued for the existing big project.
Okay, so you'll recheck the alignments and the descriptions of those?
Right. I mean, they will be as shown on the approved 1991
okay.
plan.
Great. Thank you. Any other discussion which
One of the discussions, I recall that there'd been a long discussion about a market survey. I guess I'm not quite so concerned about a market survey. I think the market should take care of itself, and it seems to have done so over the last 6 or 7 years. But I think part of this is financial capability, which the town deals with, I think, more directly with through the bond requirement. Is there a bond that's being submitted for the public improvements or the access trails or anything like that, Maureen, or any other, like for the sidewalk or anything that the board should be aware of?
As part of the 1991 approval, it was anticipated that a bond would be submitted. The ordinance required at that time that if you had more than $10,000 worth of improvements, that you would have to bond for it as part of site plan approval. What I can do is just find that original approval and read to you the conditions, but I believe there was a specific condition that talked about landscaping and that there would have to be a bond for the landscaping.
Mr. Chairman, could I assist again while Maureen is looking? Yes, a performance guarantee was required by the original approval when another prospective buyer actually pulled the building permit in 1996. The amount of the performance bond was agreed upon at that time was pretty hefty. I think it was something like $165,000 is the number that sticks in my mind. I couldn't find it in my file. But yes, we understand that there will be a performance guarantee, probably a letter of credit posted for the required improvements, the sidewalk and the landscaping and so forth. And the amount may be adjusted some with this project, although probably not much because it wasn't driven by the cost of the building. It was driven by the cost of those improvements. And that, I think, in 96, at the time of building permit, those amounts were reviewed by the town's consulting engineers and an amount was agreed upon. And that's what Care Matrix is proposing to do again, and we recognize that's a requirement of the approval.
Thank you.
The original approval in 1991 had seven conditions on them. The seventh condition was that a bond be required to be posted in an amount equivalent to the landscaping costs along the Elizabeth Park properties to ensure that such landscaping be completed when the project is completed. I believe the bond that was eventually agreed to also included the cost of the sidewalk that was going to be constructed along Scott Dyer Road.
I have a question which perhaps someone could clarify a little further. Changing the name under the application to Care Matrix Cape Elizabeth, is this actually what is intended to be on the sign identifying the property, or is this something that's for the application from this point forward only and is not necessarily the final moniker of the project?
Mr. Chairman, again, Kevin Fadden from Care Matrix. That would be the name of the proposed facility. Yeah. Most of our facilities throughout the country are Care Matrix of in the community that we're located in. That's kind
okay.
of a trademark. So that in some of the packets that I had dropped off last yeah. time, you'd see the facilities that we have that we operate and control and other ones that are under construction. And those, it's usually the way it's done is Care Matrix of.
Okay. Thank you. Is there any other discussion from board members? questions or insights? Mr. Parker.
I have a motion.
Thank you.
Motion for the board to consider. Number one, findings of fact. First Atlantic Corporation is requesting amendments to the previously approved site plan for Elizabeth Heights, a 60-unit congregate care project located on Scott Dyer Road, R5-2. Number two, in accordance with the emergency ordinance adopted by the Town Council, the amendments shall be reviewed for compliance with the zoning ordinance in effect prior to May 1990. Number three, the previously approved plans include information which has not been resubmitted for these amendments. Number four, the plans substantially comply with Section 19-2-9, Site Plan Review, and Section 19-3-15, Housing for the Elderly. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of First Atlantic Corporation for amendments to the previously approved site plan for Elizabeth Heights, a 60-unit congregate care project located on Scott Dyer Road, R5-2, be approved subject to the following conditions. Number one, that this approval incorporates all the previously approved plans that have not been amended as part of this approval, and two, that there be no alteration of the site nor issuance of a building permit until all the conditions of the previous approval and this approval have been met and revised plans have been submitted to the town planner and town engineer for review and approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion at this point? Mr. Emery.
On the first condition, that this approval incorporates all the previously approved plans that have not been amended as part of this application, is it assumed then that all the plans that are amended are also part of this application?
It sounds like it would be to me.
Yes, therefore be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted, I think.
But we haven't received anything. We don't have a formal plan that lays out what's been amended. We have discussions and we have schematic plans. Mm. But I know that there's a condition here that those plans be submitted to the town. I just don't want the fact that because the garage is taken off the site plan, that site plan is no longer part of the application. I would say all previously approved plans and amended plans.
Discussion amongst board members as to whether that would be
certainly would defer to the
desirable language
with any comment or recommendation on that language. It's
the concern is that the applicant has presented plans to you this evening which have never been reviewed by town staff. Aside from the 8.5 by 11 color drawing, I have nothing of any of the new stuff that was submitted this evening. The description of the fire lane and the fire hydrant is a plan that I've never seen, that I don't know if the fire chief has ever seen. My concern is that not with condition one, but where it refers to me in condition two, if the board approves this evening and plans are submitted and I review them with other staff, and I don't believe that they are what the board approved this evening or what was represented to the board this evening, there could be some confusion.
And your solution is?
The board in the procedures requires that all application materials have to be submitted 18 days before a meeting.
Chairman, try to address that concern.
Yes, please address the board.
What Mr. Cushing has presented tonight, this colored up version, is the site plan that was presented to you as part of the application with basically two new things, the landscaping and the island of the parking area and a delineation of the fire lane. Other than that, it's the same site plan that was part of the application for the amendment that was submitted to you. We apologize to the board. This project has involved folks in Massachusetts and in Maine trying to work together, and Mr. Cushing didn't get on the job until past the submissions deadline for his landscaping component of it. But let me suggest a possibility, which is that as much as I'm sure Frank's heart would be broken to part with his colored up plan here, I mean, we can leave that with you as sort of the word escapes me, the reference plan, so that when we then submit to the town planner the final plan with all the details added to it and so forth, you have in the town office what the reference is, so that if the planner's concern is that something comes into her and she doesn't know if that's what the board saw tonight, we can certainly leave that with you. And in terms of the landscaping detail, of course, that has been provided to you by Mr. Cushing tonight.
Thank you. This, to my fellow board members, this presumably could be somehow or other worded. In condition number one, to include more than what it says right now, would anyone have any interest in figuring out such semantics?
Well, at this point, then, there have been no plans amended as part of this approval. There have been no plans officially received and reviewed by the planning board. Is that correct?
Last month's plans.
This is the package we have here.
Right. The basic amendments are on we submitted an amended site plan with this application for an amendment.
That's it.
And that showed removal of the parking structure. It didn't show the landscaping, and it didn't show the fire hydrants, but it showed where the parking structure was removed, and it also showed the different configuration of the building. Mm-hmm. And the facades, that's right. That was all part of the application.
I really hate to be technical about this, but having done a few of these myself, if I go to, the concern is when it leaves this room, whatever is the record is a record, and it's very easy for an applicant to go to a town manager or to go to a council member and say, this was not approved, it's not on the plan. And I trust everyone sitting there, but I know how hard everyone has to work in order to meet deadlines. I don't have any problem this evening approving this project. I really don't. But I just want to know what's being approved. There's nothing on this previous plan that references, I'm looking, is this the correct plan? It's not labeled as having been removed. And again, it's a technicality, and I don't mind making it a condition of approval, but it's extremely irregular for a project of this size, I think, not to have submitted the plans that you expect us to approve as part of this amended application, because it is an amended application. Is that not correct?
We'll offer if we can. This can be your record document, and I'm sure Frank can very quickly then provide additional copies for what you need in the various town departments. What we're asking the board to approve is this plan that is sitting up on the board, which is what we submitted, with the green colored material having been added in, the additional landscaping in the island and the location of the
additional.
I think
the assumption the board will have to make, and if there's any issue with respect to what's approved and what's built, it would be whatever plan is previously approved that's not submitted, specifically requesting amendment, would be what we would expect. And I don't recall if the earlier plan called for some elaborate treatment at the Port Cachere in terms of paving, or I don't even know if it got to that level of detail, but I would expect to go to the site and see that. I know that there was a quality of finish to this project that really was part of this overall approval that I think shouldn't be lost in the amendment process unless it's specifically requested. I guess let me ask once again, are there specific plans, previously approved plans, that have been amended? There's no plan that this planning board has in front of it that was prepared by Gowan Associates, which is the official record, certified by Les Berry or by, I mean, BH2M or by Gowron Associates that has been submitted as part of this package, specifically referencing amendment requests or anything like that. So in terms of the formal record, there's nothing in front of us that specifically references an existing plan that's been amended. Is that correct?
See if we can get our terminology straight here. I understand what your concern is, Tom. And in 1991, the Planning Board approved a whole set of plans. Those are on record in the town office. And this proposed motion incorporates all those and all the conditions attached to those into this approval of the amendment. So what we have submitted to you is simply plans showing the changes. So if I believe if you adopt this motion, that what you will be doing is approving the amendments and incorporating all the previously approved plans, which are of record in the town office, into this approval. It's not a new approval of the whole project. It's just an approval of the amendment. So we did not resubmit to the Planning Board all the volumes of data that are on record in the town office showing what the 1991 approval was. But we understand that that all is still in effect, except for these couple of changes shown on this plan.
Okay, so I guess my suggested change to the first condition would be that I would see, unless any other members of the board or the planner suggests otherwise, that first condition be amended to read that this approval incorporates all previously approved plans, period.
Yep. Please repeat that.
That this approval incorporates all the previously approved plans. Since none of the previously approved plans have been amended.
I think, I don't know, I mean, I read this and my understanding was what Mr. Vaniotis just explained. Now, if there's a way to clarify it, I understand where you're going and I understand what you want. If there's a way to clarify it that's better than what's here, I'm all for it. The alternative, it seems to me, is to table the thing and then get everyone satisfied with a set of plans. But my understanding, again, was what was just explained to us.
Mr. Chairman, could I make a suggestion about language and see if it's acceptable to Mr. Emery, if it accomplishes what he wants? I think I understand his concern.
I had one which I would like to just kind of float to my fellow board members first.
Okay.
That have not been amended as part of this approval be dropped. I agree with that. Mm-hmm. And in its place include and amended plans presented or and plans presented. So that we pull in the up to the minute plans which show the fire lane being extended and the fire hydrant and the landscaping of the island.
That's fine.
I think that would perhaps sort of bring things into a little bit better focus.
I would be happy to accept that amendment to my initial. Keeps everyone happy on the board.
And I continue to agree to a second.
Okay. Is there any further discussion?
Should we just read the wording of that point again?
I think that's a very good idea.
As amended?
Very good idea.
Excuse me. You're the one that proposed the wording.
I'll read it then.
Please.
One, that this approval incorporates all the previously approved plans and plans presented, semicolon, and.
Thank you.
Is there any further discussion?
Let me be real retentive about this. Were all the plans that were presented approved? Anything that we were presented, we're giving carte blanche approval. Is that what we mean to say? Does anyone have any concern with that? I'm not trying to be difficult. I just don't want any confusion about what's approved and what isn't.
If it's at all helpful.
Let me just tell you where I'm coming from. Yeah. I really would like to table this, have the plan submitted like everybody else has to do, like every firm in the state has to do. It's only the fact that this project has been before the town for the last 7 years or longer that I have some interest, or I don't want to slow up a closing if that's the issue. I would really like to have the planning board have an opportunity to see the same plans that the town planner and the town engineer are going to see as part of the final amended package.
Maureen, do you have the, I don't know if the right is the right way to phrase it, but can you bring it back to the board if you have some concerns?
Yes.
Say, I'm not comfortable with the plans that I've been presented and the town engineer has been presented. I would like to have the planning board look at this again. Do you have that capability or that right to exercise that?
Potentially.
Condition 2 states that it must be approved by her.
Yeah.
Does this indicate a level of effort where all of the old plans are compared to all of the new plans?
Oh, yeah, that...
By someone other than the building inspector? I mean, from a planning perspective? It could be a significant job.
Oh, that's a given with the approach that's been taken. That's a given. And what, you know, there really ought to be clear notes on the current plan, that talks about it supersedes previous approvals where there are inconsistencies, because, you know, all the other plans that were approved in 91 show a building footprint, show a covered parking garage, and, you know, in some cases they show a fire lane, maybe some cases they don't. So there's going to have to be some clear notes in the plan so that a year from now everyone, you know, you got to remember that, not, you know, there's going to be times when none of us that are in this room are going to be working on this site. And there's going to be a couple of guys holding up plans, and they're going to try to figure out which one is the one they're supposed to be following, if they have plans. So there's that complication right to begin with.
My understanding, and perhaps Ken Hagen can help me here, is that the site plan we submitted to you, and this is that site plan, again, with a few things that have been added tonight, is the site plan that was approved in 1991. You didn't draw this from scratch, did you?
No.
Ken?
If I can pull out the other one.
I think another way of asking that question is, Mr. Cushing and BH2M going to be the landscape architect and civil engineer of record for this project?
That's correct.
When these plans come in for a building permit, they'll be the same plans prepared by the same consultants?
That's right.
Yes.
Okay.
This is the plan that you have, which shows the parking structure deleted. It does not show the fire lane extension. It does not show the detail of the landscape.
Okay, thank
those
you.
Are the differences.
But other than that, that's the 1991.
Yes, this was traced over the 1991 plan.
Yeah, and the only, let me just explain for the public what can happen on a construction site. A contractor can send out a drawing